I know God could come into your life and my life any day. And he could say, and I know, because I know the words are in my mouth also. And God would say, what are you so afraid of? Why are you so afraid? You're afraid of speaking in public. You're afraid of praying. You're afraid of sitting in a front row. Not that you are, I'm just saying. You're afraid of change. You're afraid of tomorrow. What are you so afraid of? Because God says, fear not. He wants to restore something to you and me. What do you think he wants to restore? He goes on to say, he says, in this passage, it says, the threshing floors will again be piled high with grain, and the presses will overflow with wine and olive oil. I guess the most known verse is verse 25. Maybe you can shout out amen after I read it. It says, and I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar, the pommel worm, my great army which I have sent upon you. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I will restore to you, God says, the years that the locusts have eaten. All right, let me finish it and then we'll talk. He goes on to say, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters, you guys know it, shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall, see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days.
Amen.
Yeah. And the Lord says this, something very powerful. He says, I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth. Blood and fire, spiritually speaking, I want you to see this. Blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood. God just says he's going to end one day and begin a new day. There's a new day for you, everybody. Your sun will be darkened. That day that you're living in that you don't want to live in, he says, your sun will be darkened. Can I get a hallelujah? Praise the Lord. Your sun shall be darkened. Well, that's called night, by the way. It's just called night. Because there's going to be a new day for you. You thought this day that you were in would never end. He says, here's the promise. You ready? The day that you're living in, he says, here's the promise. Your sun shall be darkened. and he says, the moon shall be turned to blood. The blood of Jesus always speaks of redemption and cleansing and forgiveness of sins. The old being forgiven and the new being born. You know, there's going to be a blood and a fire and a smoke. And the sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood. Before what? Before the great dreadful day of the Lord. Before the day of the Lord, everybody. Before the day of the Lord. And everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So I recommend you call upon him. I don't know if I should call upon him. Call upon him. Everyone who calls upon him shall be saved. Say, Jesus, I need you. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said. And among the survivors, those who call upon the name of the Lord. You know, as I was growing up in the church, and perhaps some of you, when you hear about the message of restoration, you might hear that well-known verse. It says, God will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. A lot of times we go to a physical place because you think it's talking about something physical. God's going to restore to you the years. What does that mean? It means you're getting your house back. You're getting your car back. What do they say? It's the country song played backwards. You get everything back. He's going to restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. You're going to get your marriage back. You're going to get your children back. You're going to get primarily your money back. That's why we all get really religious. Oh, praise Jesus! I'm going to be rich. He's going to restore to you the fortunes. I knew it. I knew it. I'm getting my fortunes. And we take the restoration in a physical place. He's going to restore my this and my that. He will bless you. Just so you know that, God's a God of blessing. He'll bless you. He's going to give all that to you. But you know that's not what he was trying to get to you in the first place. You know that, right? You know the primary thing that God's going to restore in your life and my life? Faith. And he will use those things to restore your faith. But always know, God's not looking to make you famous, wealthy, rich, successful, strong, beautiful. That's not God's plan in your life. I know it's your plan for your life. And I know you pursue it, and fine, go ahead, enjoy it. Some of you are, you know, halfway there. Some of you are all the way there. You come to church and you pray to God and you look for restoration, and God, you're going to restore the years that the locusts have eaten. And all the things you lost, you won back. Okay. Okay. But know what God is really trying to get back into your life, because he loves you. And if he gives faith back to you, you get everything. You know that? He wants to put faith back in your life. God wants to restore to you faith. Faith in God. Right? And he'll use these things to make that happen. You know, there's a story in the Bible that Jesus talked about. Jesus talked about the story of a widow. And she went before a judge, and she asked for a certain thing. She asked for mercy. She asked for justice. But the judge kept telling her, get out of my sight. You're bothering me. You're annoying me. So you know what that widow did? She annoyed him 2 times a day, 3 times a day, 4 times a day. Until that judge finally said, you are the biggest pain in my neck. I think he said that exactly. No. He might have used different words. Because he was an unjust judge. And he said to the those around him, give that woman whatever she wants, man. Give her whatever she wants. And you know, sometimes we focus on the whatever we want. Oh, I get whatever I want. Okay, fine. But it's really not a message of that. It's a message of faith, because as it goes on, it says this. Jesus says, nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, he says, will he find faith in the earth? God's not looking for your physical fortunes to be returned. He says, when I come back, are you going to have your house? Are you going to have your car? Are you going to have your wife? Are you going to have your children? No, he doesn't say that. Those things are beautiful, but he says, are you going to have faith? Are you going to have faith? Because sometimes we have faith when we want everything, and when we get everything, we kind of lose our faith. He says, you're going to have faith? Faith is what drove the widow. She constantly went before God because she believed it was going to happen. She didn't give up. She believed. Even in the face of an unjust judge, she believed in God Almighty. This man might be the most evil person on earth, but I don't believe in him. I believe in God. Yeah. So the Lord said, when he comes back to the earth, he said, will I find faith? God wants to restore your faith, everybody. And in preparation of our talk today, I believe God says specifically he wants to restore to you. This is what God, this, and I believe even as we walked in the doors this morning, I could like point every one of you out, or some of you out, what God wants to give to you in your life. Some of you God wants to restore. He wants to restore your faith in God, because some of you don't believe in God anymore. So he wants to give you faith. Some of you God wants to give you faith in God. Some of you don't need faith in God. Some of you need faith in humanity, because you don't believe in people anymore. You believe the world is filled with evil people, and you teach and you learn and you live avoiding people, and God wants to give you faith in people again. Faith in humanity. Some of you, God wants to give faith in his word. He wants you to believe the word of God again. Some of us have lost our faith in the word. You know why? Because it seems like I read it, nothing happens anyway. Ah, whatever. Whatever. You're making me seem like I'm all alone on that one. Anybody ever? It don't work. It don't work. It don't work. God says, I want to make you believe again. God's all about faith. You know that, right? It's not about making you rich and glorious and beautiful. It's about making you people of faith. And we lose that idea in the day and the age that we live in. He just wants to give you faith. If you have faith, you have everything. He wants you to believe in the word of God again. Some of you, he wants you to believe in prophecy and promises again. You've heard so many prophecies and promises, you don't believe in any of them anymore. Somebody wants to come to you, or you might believe, someone might want to promise you, God himself says, I want to do this in your life. And you say, I don't believe you. God says, prophesy in those last days, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Upon all flesh, you say, whatever. And he wants you to believe in prophecy again. Is there an amen or something out there? He wants to restore your faith, everybody. Some of you, and I think our primary today is this. He wants to restore your faith in life again. He wants to restore your faith in life. He wants you to believe that life is good. He wants you to believe that he wants you to enjoy this life. Right? He's not looking to kill you off to get you to heaven. That's it. Some of you want to die to get there, but because you have no faith. Some of you are ready to die because you have no faith in this life. Jesus said, I want you to have an abundant life. I want you. I think God wants to give us a gift. He wants to cause you to have faith in life again. To enjoy it. To look forward to it. To wake up in the morning and say, I get another one. Like maybe Russ did. I get another one. You mean I get another one, Lord? Oh, that's really great. What am I going to do with today? Can you give me a whole bunch more, Lord? He wants to restore your faith in life again. You know, forgive me, but forgive me. I believe that I was reminded of the lyrics of an old Billy Joel song. And I know our Pastor Phil will enjoy this, and I'm not asking you to name that tune. But I believe you can name that tune. I say, name that tune, and I'll give you three lyrics. Name that tune. For fun. If you know the song, let's shout it out, okay? But I was reminded of an old Billy Joel song. I was really moved by it this week, quite honestly. And it says this. Ready? Well, you guys are ready to name the title of the song. It's a Billy Joel song that says, really, don't give up on life. And I think the starting lyrics say this. Some people stay far away from the door if there's a chance of it opening up. Some people stay away from the door. If there's a chance of it opening up, they hear the voice in the hall and hope that it just passes by. You know it yet? What is it? I knew it. I can name that tune in two lyrics. An innocent man. Billy Joel, I am an innocent man. Thanks for your interest. I'm going to read some more lyrics. Some people live with the anger of having been a fool. They will never listen to anybody, or they will not listen to anyone, so nobody tells them a lie. Some people say they will never believe another promise because of all of the past broken promises. Some people run from a possible fight because they don't think they can win it. And I would add to his lyrics and say, and even if you seemingly lose the fight, aren't some fights still worth to have? Even if you lose the fight, God still says, fight the fight. Because there's another day. Amen. He says, don't give up on life. Yeah. That's powerful. It really is. What else we got here? You know, I believe that God speaks to us even through some of these lyrics. And he says this. God says this to you and me. He says, I know the reason why you live that way is because you're protecting yourself. Because you don't want to be hurt anymore. If I don't listen to you, you can't lie to me. If I don't believe in your promise, when it doesn't come to pass, I can't be hurt. If all the noise is in the hallway, the life that's to be lived, and I just shut my door and walk away, I can never be hurt by it, but you can never enjoy it. We kind of lost our faith in life. We kind of lost our faith in God. We kind of lost our faith in humanity. We lost faith. And let me tell you something. Without faith, you cannot live this life. Amen. I don't care if you call yourself a Christian or a non-Christian. No human being can live this life without faith. You got to believe in something. You got to believe in the impossible. You got to believe in a man that walks the streets one day is a man that leads the church the next day. You got to believe in the impossible. You got to believe in God. You got to keep on listening to people and looking for the goodness in people, and don't give up because you don't see it yet. You can't shut out humanity as if all people are bad because two people or three people did you wrong. You can't give up on the relationships because they don't seem to work no more. You can't stop fighting because you lost the last 20 fights. Don't stop fighting. And I think what God wants to give back to us, I believe it with all my heart. I believe that God wants to give you something very simple but very powerful. What does he want to give you, everybody? Faith. Isn't that what the church is all about? You didn't come here to get money, did you? You didn't come here to get a house, did you? A car, did you? You didn't come here to get a job, did you? You didn't come here so God would help you pass your test or get that thing. That's not why you came today, right? You came because you need faith. You came because you need faith. If God gives me faith, I can not only get through anything, I can actually enjoy my life. I can actually live a large life. You see, I know you might have come looking for those things, and God will put those things in your life to get you through the doors. Because he's going to use all those things in your life to give you faith. Faith in life, faith in God, faith in humanity, faith that the impossible can come true. Faith that when all seems lost, you're the one that stands up and says, I don't think it's quite lost yet. I might have lost a whole bunch of times, but I'm not done fighting. Right, everybody? Yeah, God wants to restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. What do you think he wants to restore to you, man? Faith. You get faith back, you get everything back. You know, amen to that, right? You know, you guys ever read the story of Ezekiel's vision of the Valley of Dry Bones? Anybody ever hear that one? Anyone ever hear about, by a raise of hands, ever hear about the dry bones, Ezekiel's vision of dry bones? Okay. Let me just read this vision. Ezekiel had a vision one day. It says this. It says, the hand of the Lord was upon me, and I was carried away by the Spirit of the Lord to a valley full of old dry bones. And they were scattered everywhere across the ground. He led me around among them, and he said to me, God said to Ezekiel, son of man, what? Can these bones live again? Can these bones live again? And in our state of unbelief, without faith, we say, nope. Dead, dry, scattered all over the place. No. But maybe today you don't say no. Maybe we can just take you one step past no. Maybe God can add just a little bit of faith to you where you don't say no, you just say, Lord, only you know. How about that? You don't have to say yes, but say, Lord, only you know. Can this thing happen in your life again? Only you know, Lord. I've seen what God can do in a man like Russell's life through people who actually love and care. Only you know, Lord. Okay. And then God told Ezekiel, he says, speak to those bones. Speak to them. Prophesy, if you will, because in those last days, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. What are you going to prophesy about? Well, let's start by speaking to some dry bones. And God wants to tell you, he says, say this. Say, oh, dry bones, listen to the words of God. For the Lord God says, see, I am among, or I am going to make you live and breathe again. Oh, wow. I'm getting a little excited. Just a little excited. Maybe God wants to make you laugh again, live again. Maybe he wants you to throw that door open and run into the hallway with the rest of them. It's like, hey, what are we shouting about? Where are we going? What are we doing? Maybe he wants you to be friends again and make friends and look for the best in people and enjoy the life that surrounds you He says, speak to the bones and say this. He says, hear the word of the Lord. Because the Lord says you're going to live and breathe again. And I will replace the flesh and the muscle on you and cover you with skin. And I will put breath in you. And you shall live and know. Once these things happen in your life, you're going to know that he is the Lord. One thing you're going to believe in, you'll believe in God again. When God does things in your life, you believe in God again. So I spoke these words from God, just as he told me to. I spoke. You know what happens if you speak the words of God? Suddenly, you might hear a rattling of noise. And it says, from all across the valley. Can you picture this? Can you picture this? I don't know if it would scare you or encourage you, but he says, I heard the bones start to rattle. Kind of sounds spooky, but I heard a rattling noise from across the valley, and the bones of each body came together. That might have been an arm over here and a leg over here and something over there, and they started like, I belong over here. He starts to put your life back together again. You can't put it back together again. You cannot put it back together again. What can you do? You can believe. What can you do? Have faith, because you can't do a thing. You can't put your life back together or anyone else's life back together. What can you do? Can you have faith? Can you speak words of faith? Because if you speak words of faith, he will cause your life to come back together again. He will cause those dead things to come back. He'll do the impossible, something you cannot do in all of your best effort. You can put all your work into it. Forget about it. Or you can just have faith in God. Go to church on a Sunday. Sing a song. Say, Lord, I leave it in your hand. I trust in you. And all of a sudden, the impossible happens. God will do something you could never do in a million lifetimes. He will do something in a million lives. You can't fix nothing. You can break it real good, but you can't fix nothing. You can make a real big mess, but you can't fix the mess. Anybody out there? I make real good messes. What are you doing agreeing with me? What? On earth, that wasn't nice at all. Yeah, we can make the mess. And God lets you because he wants to restore faith into your life. Know that somehow God is in your brokenness. Like he allowed the brokenness to happen. Like in the book of Joel, God says that he sent that army in your life. He sent the destruction in your life. Why? Because life was more than about the things. Life was about faith. He wants to put faith in your life. He wants to make you believe in the invisible. Believe in God. Believe in the impossible. He wants you to believe again. Believe in life. That life is good and large. And there's a blessing in this life. This life is, sometimes I believe we're downcast, like there's a shadow over us, like our eyes are to the earth and we can't look up. It's like we're bound or closed in and we can't experience life because it was taken from us. It was taken from us, like we can't enjoy and enter in. And God says, I'm going to give it back to you. So he spoke the words and there was this rattling noise and everything came together. And Ezekiel says, it says that I just stood back and I watched. What's your role in this? You trust God and then just sit back and watch. Okay? Why don't you watch? And it says muscle and flesh formed over the bones. And skin covered them. But it says, but the bodies had no breath in them. Like they came back, the bones came back together, muscle and skin, and they looked good, but there was no breath in them. So, story's not over. So the Lord told to me, he says, you call for the breath. You call for the breath to enter into their bodies. You call for the winds. You say, the Lord God says, come forth, four winds, O Spirit, and breathe upon these slain bodies, that they may live again. Listen, God's going to do the absolute, extraordinary, miraculous, and what you're going to do is, you're going to breathe life into it. Your faith will cause you to breathe life into it. Amen. And you will have the joy that you want in life. You will have the blessings that you want in life. But always know the source of it all. It's faith in God Almighty. And when all these things happen in your life and all of your dead bones come back to life again, the greatest thing that God is going to restore to your life, the greatest thing that God is going to restore to your life, because he'll make all these dead things come alive again, but it's going to restore faith back to you. It's going to restore faith back to me. Faith in God. Faith in people. You're going to start, sometimes they say it's easy to believe in God, but yeah, okay, why don't you believe in people again? Believe in humanity. It's Stop it. Just breathe life into it. Amen. Mm-hmm. And then these things shall come to pass. It says, so I spoke as he commanded to me, and these bodies came up, and he said, before he knew it, before Ezekiel knew it, he says, there was a real big army right in front of me, man. God's going to cause a lot of things to come back to life for you. And know this, know this, know this. The restoration that God wants you to have, he wants you, first and foremost, everybody, listen, as you leave the church house today, have faith. Have faith. Have faith in God. That's all you got to do. Have faith. Have faith in each other. Believe in each other. Why don't you start loving each other again? Enjoying. Let's. How about we do this? How about we do this? How about we start enjoying our relationships again with each other? Stop thinking the worst of each other or the contentions. Why don't we just start enjoying each other again? Why don't we go into a strange atmosphere and just enjoy the people around us? Not think the worst or the negative. Why don't we just enjoy humanity and believe in people? Why don't you believe in life, that life is good? It's not hard. Don't let those words come out of your mouth. Life is not hard. And if you can't say life is good, maybe you can say what? Maybe you can say God is good. Maybe just God is good. So it's going to be all right. Amen, everybody. May God restore your faith. You know, in closing, I'm going to ask Pastor Phil if he'll join me up here. And, you know, we said one of the things that God wants to do is he wants to add faith back. But I think also with that, you have to have some kinds of seed. You got to have seeds of faith. You got to plant some things because you believe in the future. So if you believe the future is going to be bright, you know, you want to invest in the future. And I think that's where our youth group comes involved too, you know. That's involved with all your life too. If you believe in a great future, invest in it, you know. Sow into it. But I think that's what God's also doing with the seeds of tomorrow. Because we believe that God has a great future for this church and for people's lives and for our youth. You know, I believe the world's going to be a better place. How's the world going to be a better place? Well, yeah, faith. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, faith. And we got to believe in the next generation, invest in them, because they're the ones that are going to rise up and they're going to become the teachers and the mentors and everything else. So let's invest in our future, because I believe in a bright future. I don't believe in a dark future. I believe in a bright future. So Pastor Phil, come on. We're going to anoint our youth ministers as we prepare to start our new youth ministry next week. So I'm going to ask and call forward. First, I'd like to call up our sister Yvonne Shadrach. Would you please come forward first? And Sister Yvonne Shadrach is going to be our youth minister. Come on forward.